All right. Hello, everyone. What's up? Welcome to the Halls Institute. My name is Brian Granger. I'm the manager of exhibitions and public programs here. Super excited to see so many people here. And I know you're looking forward to what should be a great lecture by Dr. Matthew Pedway on race and slavery in Cuba. Right before I do start, I just want to let you know this event and this exhibition are sort of connected to a program at the college called Cuba and El Horizonte. And so there are many more events related to Cuba, you know, music, theater, dance, stuff like that, more lectures and films as well. So I encourage you to pick up a we've got calendars here at the front desk, so grab one of those on your way out for more events related to Cuba. So to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Matthew Pedway is a postdoctoral fellow here in the School of Languages, Cultures, and World Affairs. He teaches Spanish and Latin American and Caribbean studies. He completed his doctorate in Hispanic Cultural Studies at Michigan State University in 2010. He has taught at Bates College and the University of Kansas in Spanish and Latin American studies. At Bates College, he was affiliated with the African American Studies program as well. This semester, here at the college, Dr. Pedway is teaching a course on the rich cultural and intellectual contributions of Black Cubans in film, fine arts, literature, and history. His book manuscript, tentatively titled Black Cuban Literature in the Age of Conspiracy, Juan Francisco Manzano and Gabriel de la Concepción Valdez, is under contract with the University Press of Mississippi. In it, Pedway argues that Black poets used the symbolic language of Catholicism, Romanticism, and Neoclassicism to represent African-inspired ideas of spirit and cosmos beneath the surface of the dominant aesthetic. And tonight, as you know, he'll be speaking on race and slavery in Cuba, giving sort of a background on these topics. And this is taking place in an exhibition of work by a Cuban artist who is currently living in Havana. His name is Roberto Diaco, and his work is abstract, but it deals with a lot of the themes that that Dr. Pedway will be talking about. So, without further ado, please welcome Dr. Matthew Pedway.
Thank you and good evening. It's an honor to be here tonight at the College of Charleston. I want to take this as an opportunity to thank the Halsey Institute for the invitation to give this talk tonight, to thank Mark Sloan, Brian Granger, Kaylee Lass, Liz, Katie, and Tatiana. I assume that is a Spanish name, Tatiana. I also want to thank Sylvia Gamboa, a professor here at the College of Charleston, who is directing the Cuba en el Horizonte program. So tonight, my lecture is called Race and the Afterlife of Slavery in Cuba. Am I too close to this?
Are you?
Okay. I know there is a slight echo in here, so we may actually hear a bit of it. I want to begin tonight by sharing with you famous Black Cuban saying, but in Cuba we call it refrán un dicho. Ser negro es vivir improvisando. To be Black is to live improvising. I want to share this with you. This is something that I've traveled to Cuba several times for research as well as to take students to Cuba. And it's something that I've heard in the process of preparing to enter a hotel. And the implication of the saying, essentially, is that in the new world, the so-called new world, Black identity is something that's not constructed once and left alone, but it's constructed, remade, negotiated, and remade again, sometimes all in one day. Thank you. When North Americans returned from travel to Havana, they exclaimed with a distinctly blissful gaze, "There's no racism in Cuba." North Americans experienced race in terms of abrasive rhetoric, a history of government segregationist policies, and an increasingly visible politics of white supremacy. But what they miss about Cuba might be best summed up in the following statement, quote, "The revolution made blacks into people," end quote. A white Cuban uttered this statement to a black coworker in the midst of a heated exchange. But this statement has a long history in Cuba. This off-the-cuff remark cannot be dismissed as mere vulgarity, because such a remark reveals the vestiges of African slavery in the Cuban imagination. Jokes, sneers, slurs, and epithets are microaggressions that convey a singular and enduring idea. Blackness is devoid of human value. Blackness is not existence. This is what Black Spanon and black skinned white mask call, quote unquote, a zone of non-being, a sense of nothingness that renders black historical presence invisible. Black Cubans experience race in terms of erasure. Cuban history renders them virtually invisible within a narrative of trans-racial brotherhood. And I want to speak briefly about the image that I have here that I was able to find on a blog where you have a black Cuban man and a white Cuban man supporting the nation. You can see that they're not looking at each other. In their work, they are probably sweating. They are holding the nation on their shoulders. They are powerful figures in that regard. But I want to point to the fact that the Cuban national narrative of transracial brotherhood actually talks about the figure of Antonio Maceo, the black Cuban general, who was the most significant figure in the Cuban Wars of Independence between 1868 and 1898, and Jose Martí. Jose Martí being the Cuban intellectual and journalist of European descent, who was called and often referred to as the apostle of Cuban independence. That Maceo Martir, familiar to anyone who knows the song Guantanamera, and Martí's negation of the existence of race, that notion that Cuban identity is based on a transracial notion of nationality devolved into the statement, "There are no blacks, there are no whites, only Cubans." In Cuban TV and film, blacks are seldom protagonists, often appearing as slaves or ciphers. Even the representation of Afro-Cuban religion in films like Miel para Ochun and Fresa en Chocolate somehow contrive white Cuban characters as the protagonists of Cuban religious systems that are indebted to Africa for their epistemological and ritual origins. So even those traditions at the beginning of the 20th century were so feared, were so attached to a notion of deviltry and Satanism, these traditions are now the face of the Cuban nation, and they're often represented with the image of a white protagonist. My lecture today is motivated by a series of meaningful and difficult questions. What is the history of race in Cuba? How does racist thinking in Cuba differ from its neighbor to the north of the United States? What is the afterlife of slavery in Cuba? And finally, how might we move toward anti-racism? In this talk, I will explore how nearly 400 years of Spanish colonialism and African enslavement invented the myth of white supremacy and nurtured the creation of another nation, black inhumanity. I will conclude by defining the power of anti-racist thinking, looking toward the philosophical contributions of the formerly enslaved and their descendants in the interest of remembering. Let me begin today by defining a series of concepts. There's two concepts in particular today that will be very important for us. The first concept is the concept of race. Now, the next one is the afterlife of slavery. So I want to begin with a definition of race that was very familiar to me in my youth, when I was much, much younger, growing up in the city of Detroit. Race was often defined by Webster's New Collegiate Dictionary, quote, a division of humankind possessing traits that are transmissible by descent and sufficient to characterize it as a distinct human type, end quote. Race was essentially a biological fact, I was taught growing up. But recent findings have disrupted scientific certainty surrounding the idea of race. Imagine that. Since the 1970s, modern science has proven Webster's dictionary wrong. Today, we know that human beings are 99.9% identical genetically, as Drs. Francis Collins and Craig Venter jointly announced at the White House on June 26, 2000, when the rough draft of the Human Genome Project was released. So science has, for more than a century, made the statement that we now know to be false, that race was essentially a biological fact. Science has turned a corner with the Human Genome Project and has been able to demonstrate that we are 99.9% genetically identical. So we're fighting over 0.1% of our genetic makeup. I want to provide you with a definition that we often use in the world of scholarship. Howard Wynant defines racial formation theory, quote, let me see if I can actually provide you with this here. I have a map of Cuba to show you. That's not being held up by two powerful men. Okay. Before I go on any further, allow me please to explain what the four stages of my lecture are. Once I've introduced concepts, I'm going to explain the Luso-Hispanic racial paradigm, discuss intellectual conversations in 19th century Cuba concerning the dream of whiteness, talk about the afterlife of slavery, and conclude with how anti-racism begins with remembrance. Let's try to find the definition here for you. Here we are. Sociologist Howard Wynant defines racial formation theory. Race is understood as fluid, unstable, and decentered complex of social meanings, constantly being transformed by political conflict. Race both shapes the individual psyche and colors, quote unquote, relationships among individuals on the one hand, and furnishes an irreducible component of collective identity and social structures on the other. For centuries, race has been a way of thinking about the moral character, cultural sophistication, and destiny of a people that creates immutable, unchangeable categories based on superficial phenotypical differences. Racism, on the other hand, is a system designed to transform fictional racial destinies into tangible realities that come to be supported by empirical evidence. So racism can be seen in institutional structures and policies. I want to talk a bit more about this, but I want to talk about it in the context of colonial Cuba. And in order to do so, we need an understanding of how race functions a bit differently in Spanish-speaking countries and in Portuguese-speaking Brazil than it does in the United States. In Colonialism and Race in Luso-Hispanic Literature, Jerome Branch argues that mestizaje, or mixedness, is not merely a phenotypical descriptor for persons of African, indigenous, and European ancestry, but rather mestizaje is a metaphor for social harmony. Mestizaje is a way of picturing race not in terms of difference, but rather as, quote, a homogeneous, racially amalgamated collectivity, end quote. In other words, a multi-hued family. This family is, of course, devoid of social conflict. Latin Americans are rhetorically equipped to describe racial intermingling as a metaphor for social harmony in light of their chosen point of comparison, the United States of America. Latin Americans juxtapose racial intermixing with the institutionalized violence of the United States Jim Crow South and the former apartheid regime in South Africa. The very visible violence of these systems of racial control stands in stark contrast with Latin American countries, where conflict is explained in terms of class inequalities. The Luso-Hispanic paradigm of white supremacy has a different history than the Anglo-Saxon theory of whiteness. Anglo-Saxon ideas of whiteness are premised on a longing for racial purity that views racial mixture, which is called in English miscegenation, as a dumbing down of a race, as a dilution of pure racial stock, as a first step on the road to perdition. Colonial Latin America instituted the inverse of the one-drop rule, so that a couple of European ancestors were thought to brighten one's complexion, straighten woolly hair, and commence an inevitable progress toward whiteness. So I want to take a moment to stop and talk about this. When I teach this in my classes, I use an article by U.S. historian Joel Cypress. And I'd like to share a story of a Louisiana woman who was phenotypically white, of European descent, but whose great-great-great-great-grandmother was an enslaved African woman who had been taken as a mistress by her owner. And the state did not qualify her as a white woman because of this great-great-great-great ancestor. Well, the inverse would be true in Latin America. Any brown-skinned person that could demonstrate that their great-great-grandfather, great-great-grandmother, usually grandfather, was of European descent, they could claim something other than blackness, something other than an indigenous identity. Anti-black racism is premised on the deliberate negation, distortion, and disavowal of the African past. German anthropologist Leo Frobenius wrote the following about pre-colonial Africa. So before discussing slavery in Cuba, I want to take a moment to encourage us to reflect on what existed prior to the foundation of Spanish and Portuguese colonies in what we now call the New World. In order to understand the Luso-Hispanic racial paradigm, I want to talk about how the myth of the Negro takes form. And in order to do so, I'm very fond of images. In order to do so, I found here for us a map. This is the, one of the year writes, the late 14th century. It's a map from Catalana, Catalunya, which is just declared independence from Spain. This is a 1375 map. And the reason why I've chosen to use this in order to introduce this Luso-Hispanic racial paradigm is because you see Iberia, and you see what is today Morocco. But you probably also notice what appears to be a Bedouin man, a Berber man, on a camel, moving in the direction of a finely dressed African monarch with a golden orb in his hand. I won't get into detail about this particular history, but this man was Mansa Musa, and he was a monarch, he was an African monarch of the Kingdom of Mali. And what's significant about this is that the probably more than other parts of Europe, Spain and Portugal had significant knowledge of Africa. And so it's not surprising that the discourse, when racial slavery is adopted as a means to provide workers for Spanish and Portuguese colonies, it's not surprising that the justifications for that, the enslavement of that workforce, would come from Portugal and Spain. But I want to suggest that the justification is coming built on the heels of a negation. I want to suggest that they knew better. Leo Frobenius wrote, quote, "Let us not forget that the first European seafarers in the late Middle Ages had already made highly reputable observations of a similar nature. When they arrived in the Bay of Guinea and went ashore in Guinea, those captains of old were greatly surprised. Well laid out streets, running for miles without interruption, lined with planted trees for days' journey, nothing but a countryside covered with fine fields, people in handwoven fabrics. Further to the south, in the Kingdom of the Congo, masses of people clothed in silks and velvets, an order which extended to the minutest details of large, well-organized states, mighty rulers, flourishing industries, culture, and the very marrow of the people. The same conditions were found in the countries on the eastern seaboard, for instance, the Mozambique coast. End quote. Frobenius argued that the myth of black inhumanity was a European creation. And he goes on to refer to these African kingdoms in the 15th through 17th century as a flower. He said, a flower that the European conquistadors destroyed wherever they were able to penetrate. Quote, for the new land of America needed slaves. Africa has slaves to offer. Slaves by the hundred, slaves by the thousands, shiploads of slaves. But traffic in human beings had never been an easy business to answer for. It demanded justification. So the Negro was transformed into a city animal, an article of trade. The concept of the barbaric Negro is a European creation, which had its effect on Europe as late as the beginning of this century. End quote. He's writing in the early 20th century. Bell Frobenius is the anthropologist that fell upon the Ife heads of Nigeria. So you can actually look him up. But I want to take a moment here to provide some of the images that he's writing about. These are actually from Ofer Dapper's description of Africa. Here is the royal court at Congo. The Kingdom of the Congo in the 15th century comes into contact with the Portuguese. And you can see here, you pay mind to the European visitors who are bowing before the royal court and before the monarch, the Manicongo. Here is an image of the city of Luango in what was part of the Kingdom of the Congo. And you can see the well laid out streets that he's talking about here. Let me share a bit more before I begin to discuss Cuba in greater detail. These are images that are far too often missing from our education, from our collective memory. We seem to have forgotten what pre-existed African slavery. These are the ruins that show up Kisiwani, Tanzania. So this is the ruins of a mosque built by African Muslims. The Portuguese described as Moors because of the dark skin. Let us continue. Black inhumanity was invented to negate African history. Portuguese chronicler Gomes de Zurara introduced a racialized ideological framework for the enslavement of Africans when he published The Chronicle of the Discovery and Conquest of Guinea in 1453. Zurara's 15th century portrayal of Africans was as distorted as it was prescriptive. Zurara equated Africans with animals. He depicted them as naked creatures bereft of reason, industriousness, without proper shelter, and living in bestial slough, quote unquote. He advanced an ethnocentric idea of culture that represented Zurara introduced a discourse on blackness inflected by Aristotle's ideas that nature endowed certain people with remarkable physical strength, but little to no mental acuity. His 1453 chronicle, honoring the exploits of Portuguese slave traders, asserted that Catholics were justified in making war on non-believers that resisted evangelization. Zurara's ideological framework presented an additional rationale for the enslavement of Africans, the divine punishment of sin. And so, what I want to demonstrate here, here's a copy, essentially, in Portuguese, Clásicos Portugueses, of this crónica. The concept of the barbaric Negro is what he's introducing here. And one of the two most important things in this particular text is the way in which Zurara is equating Africans with animals, but also justifying their enslavement based upon a punishment, divine punishment for sin. This is where the myth of Ham comes in. We don't have time here to discuss that. But I do want to introduce Zurala's text. The next section here is concerning the intellectual tradition of white Cuban scholars. Cuban historian Manuel Moreno Fraginal described Cuban sugar plantations as, quote, sugar-producing jails. Cuban slave labor camps depended almost entirely on the sustained importation of new African labor to maintain productivity levels and profitability. This translated into a predominantly African-born population on the sugar and coffee estates in the rural areas. So on average, we had 96 out of 100 workers that were actually African-born, and the ratio between male and females also was very significant. Plantations did not increase the enslaved population through procreation for two primary reasons. There was a gender imbalance on plantations, and life expectancy for slaves was extremely short. For instance, from 1791 to 1822 on Havana plantations, there were two women for every eight men. Such a radical gender imbalance impeded sexual reproduction, and the natural growth of the Cuban-born slave population was severely stunted. Let me provide you with a couple of images here. This is an image of the sugar harvest, known in Spanish as La Safra. And I'm going to describe very briefly the type of work regime that was in place. And in order to do so, I'm going to cite from the work of the great historian Gwendolyn Bidwell Hall. She published one of the first comparative colonial histories looking at Haiti or San Domingo in Cuba. Sugar plantations developed coercive labor regimes where the activities of slaves were meticulously scripted and carefully monitored. Gwendolyn Bidwell Hall explains that the sugar production process had four primary steps and needed to be carried out in quick succession. Here they are. First, the cutting of large cane stalks. So we look at the men with the machete. This is what they're doing. They're cutting the stalks. Maybe you'll notice the man here holding the stalks or carrying the stalks. He had to grab the stalks very quickly because there was a need to immediately grind the sugar cane. The boiling and the evaporation of cane juice, okay, was the next step in the process, which became guarapo, molasses. And the final stage was the production of crystallized sugar. Notice the children here in this particular image, the children aren't working, but in reality they would have been working. Harvest season lasted 5 to 6 months out of the year, and work gangs, known as dotaciones, were made to work 18 to 20 hours per day. This meant that during La Safra, enslaved Africans worked nights and on Sundays in spite of legislation designed to provide for the day off. The overwork of the plantation system left bondsmen a mere 5 hours of sleep, and under such conditions, even oxen were reduced to skeletons. This is what Bidwell Hall says. Large property owners demanded an almost humanely impossible work regime in order to offset the reality of an uncertain labor supply and the rising and falling market value of enslaved laborers. The ever-changing market conditions were another factor, since like any other commodity, the price of sugar would go up, they would go down. A British ban on the transatlantic slave trade since 1807 further worried Cuban planters that the labor supply might vanish, the overworked enslaved workers that they already had. Moreover, high sugar prices became an incentive for planters to work the plantation population even harder in order to exact the maximum profit possible from their labor. So the case of Cuba is particularly harsh because the majority of Africans brought to Cuba against their will are brought in the 19th century. So if we remember that the British abolished the transatlantic slave trade in 1807, then we know that slave traders, some from the United States, and some who were Spanish, were looking to bring human cargo in a way that could not be detected. They were looking for clandestine measures, essentially, to bring in human cargo. And so they were more likely to throw people overboard, those sorts of things, if they thought that it threatened them being essentially discovered. For enslaved men and women, dignified survival was the clear priority. However, the survival of Africans and their offspring was greatly imperiled by the number of hours they were made to work, the little rest they received, harsh physical abuse, and the exceptionally high infant mortality rates. And this is very important here. Life expectancy was dreadfully short for enslaved sugarcane workers, who on average lived only 7 years. The problem was so severe that the death rate of enslaved people exceeded the childbirth rate. As Cuban historian Moreno Fraquinao makes abundantly clear, both African and Cuban-born women were very small minorities on coffee and sugar estates. Planters perceived male workers to be more capable of doing field labor and did not pay the expense of birthing and caring for newborns. They reasoned it was easier to replace any loss to the workforce, any loss from deaths, runaways, physical incapacity, someone who was no longer physically able to work, by simply purchasing more captives. And so it created essentially a vicious cycle. As a result of this profit-motivated thinking, pregnant women did not receive proper care and were required to work in the fields until the final 2 months of the gestation period. So try to imagine anyone you know that's been pregnant. I would not personally know, but anyone who has been pregnant, and try to imagine whatever difficulties they encounter, how might those difficulties be exponentially worsened, exacerbated by being made to work such arduous labor. So here's what we have. Here's an example of a woman working. Okay, this began to change the gender imbalance began to change by about the 1850s, when greater attention was paid to the imbalance. Here's another image that I want to share with you. This one is actually not from Cuba or from the Spanish-speaking Caribbean. As you notice here, it's from the French West Indies and it's from an earlier period in the 1600s or the 17th century. But I wanted to demonstrate that there's a sugar mill here, to give you an idea of how the sugar mill might have been. The images that I found for Cuba really look so lovely and so beautiful that I think they belie the nature of the plantation as a sugar labor camp. Let's take a moment here to explore what I mean by dreaming of a white Cuba. Okay, I'm going to begin with an image here, something that I want to do in my classes. This image is actually from the Costa paintings, from a Mexican painter. And what it says in Spanish is, De español y negra produce mulato. So you won't speak Spanish, you'll get that. I'm not going to ask my students what that means. But from a Spaniard and a black boy, you produce or you get a mulato child. So significant, these paintings were very common. You have a woman of African descent, presumably African, a Spanish man, and you have a child who is slightly browner or a lighter brown, essentially. And here is the Spanish statement here at the bottom, essentially. So I'm showing you this because when we discuss the inverse of the one-drop rule in Latin America, it's not sufficient to say that anyone who could demonstrate any brown-skinned person, any person who's phenotypically indigenous, phenotypically of African descent, that could demonstrate that they had a grandmother, grandfather usually, right, who was European, could they claim a mulatto identity or claim perhaps a mestizo identity? That would be insufficient because in the Cuba case, the vehicle for mestizo, so the vehicle for mestizaje, symbolically speaking, is actually the mulatto woman. Okay, so I'm showing you here an example from the Casta paintings, the Mexican Casta paintings, so you can get an idea, because these are the erotics essentially of reforming or whitening the nation. And it was the type of thing that someone like José Antonio Sacco felt the need to be embarrassed about. José Antonio Sacco might be considered the father of racist ideas in Cuban history, but if Sacco is deserving of such an ignominious title, it is not because he was the author of racist ideology. Rather, as one of the earliest Cuban nationalists, Sacco possessed the material wealth and the acumen necessary to conceive an image of Cuba that would remain in the national imagination long after his demise. As the saying goes, it is easy to kill an individual. It is not easy to kill an idea. That's attributed to Medgar Evans. In a letter to Gonzalo Alfonso, who was a wealthy owner himself of European descent, José Antonio Sacco wrote the following: if mestizos are born from the union of a white woman and a black man, this would be regrettable. This would diminish our white population and weaken it in every conceivable aspect. But since the contrary is true, i.e., unions between black women and white men are more common, far from considering it a danger, I consider it positive. The great illness of the island of Cuba consists in the immobility of the black race. By preserving her color and primitive origin, to remain separated from the white race by impenetrable barrier, but mobilizing, it would be, allow this kind of movement, and then the barrier will start to collapse in stages until finally it disappears. Okay. So I want to point here to José Antonio Sacco. This is an image of José Antonio Sacco's thinking, a picture of José Antonio Sacco. And I want to focus a little bit on his thinking. In Sacco's worldview, whiteness was not only desirable for the island of Cuba, it was achievable. Sacco considered Afro-Cuban skin color and ancestry the twin impediments of Cuban social, cultural, and political progress. But the Cuban dream was beset with the African presence, which Sacco termed the great illness of the island of Cuba. The African presence, which had enriched the white Cuban planter class exponentially, was now deemed a pathology. The whitening of Cuba would occur on two levels. Whiteness would eradicate Cuba's African origins, and it would lighten the collective complexion of the population. As Sacco put it, the barrier will start to collapse in stages until finally it disappears, quote, unquote. So the significance here said Sacco actually saw transracial sexual relationships between European men and African women, or women of African descent, regardless of their hue, as a way of whitening the race. And this is very important because in some regard, Sacco is telling on himself. So these are the erotics, essentially, of whitening. The whitening of Cuba would occur on these two levels. Sacco's dream of a white Cuba would be achieved through the sexual conquest of African descended women. Blanquealiento, which is the word in Spanish, assumed that black would yield to white, and the disgrace of African ancestry would gradually but certainly dissipate. José Antonio Sacco's dream of the mulatto woman as a transitional figure from black to white was typical of Luso-Hispanic notions of white supremacy. I want to take a moment here to discuss another white Cuban intellectual who had a similar view. His name was Domingo de Monte. De Monte was actually considered a progressive thinker for his time. He was a member of a wealthy slaveholding family in Western Cuba. He was the patron of an Afro-Cuban writer that I'm writing my book on, Juan Francisco Manzano, one of the two writers that my book explores. And he was actually against the transatlantic slave trade. So in those regards, everything except for the first thing, perhaps, the fact he's from the slaveholding family, we might look to him as a good example of progressive politics. But Domingo de Monte bemoaned Spanish complicity in the slave trade, noting that the importation of African captives to Cuba imperiled, quote, unquote, the salvation and future prosperity of the island. De Monte feared that his cry for white European immigration would be muted by the fact that the manual labor in Cuba was inextricably linked to black slavery. So he's concerned that European men might not be willing to come to Cuba to work because manual labor itself is now so inextricably linked with blackness. Blackness representing the nadir fear of degradation in that society, that they might not be willing to take jobs cutting sugar cane. And that sugar cane had to be cut, and it had to be cut very quickly and moved through the process in order to be developed. So the monk is essentially looking for a way to do a couple of things. He wants to hold on to his economic privilege, but he's also thinking about the future of Cuba. He can't imagine a Cuba that would be anything but white. He advocates for the abolition of the slave trade with that purpose in mind. He described the situation to Irish abolitionist Richard Robert Madden of Cuba being surrounded on all sides by blacks that would ruin the island, disturb the racial order, overturn the racial order, and would themselves become owners of the island, quote unquote. The expression of Spanish is dueños de la isla, dueños de la isla. And this is significant because what Del Monte is pointing to here essentially is the Haitian Revolution, is that fear that the Haitian Revolution might spread, that Cuba itself might give way to black social revolution based on principles of anti-slavery. Let me move back here to talk about the afterlife of slavery. And I want to begin by providing you with the definition I promised you. Then I want to share a story of a trip that I made to Cuba, feels like many moons ago now, in 2012, at another college, working with students. And the ways in which that particular trip provided an opportunity to explore the afterlife of slavery. So how might we define it? The afterlife of slavery might best be defined in the words of Meg Samuelson as a haunting, as that which washes up from the wreckage of history is recycled as troubling recurrence in the present, end quote. African-American theorist Saida Hartman does not seek redemptive closure to the slave past, but rather recognizes that such closure is illusory. It is a sort of wishful thinking conceived to do away with age-old wounds whose scars remain on the collective body. So we might think of Roberto Diago's artistic presentation here, where the wealthy of the attempt to suture wounds that have been bleeding for a long time. In Saida Hartman's view, intellectuals, quote, must conjure the ghost of slavery to incite the hopes of transforming the present, quote unquote. Hartman concludes, quote, if the ghost of slavery still haunts our present, it is because we are still looking for an exit from the prison, quote unquote. This is from her book, Losing Your Mother. So I want to briefly talk here about this image. This is an image of a slave plantation outside in the province of Matanzas, Cuba, called Pirato, Triumvirate would essentially be the English translation. And so you might look and say, well, where's the sugar mill you promised me, Prophet? What is this? So this is interesting because this was actually the site of an anti-slavery insurrection led by black Cubans, and the figure in the middle is Carlota, who was a black Cuban woman who was key to the success of this insurrection. The figures themselves are an example of social realism influenced by Soviet art. And so this explains some of the poses and whatnot. But I want to talk about that wreckage that washes up, those tensions that people of different racial groups feel when they find someone of the other group in a space they didn't think they exist, the fear that the other person might just bring up the true nature of the conflict. Nearly 6 years ago, Professor Val Carnegie and I took an ethnically and racially diverse, brilliant group of students to Havana and Matanzas as part of a course on post-Soviet Cuba. Of the seven or so sessions that my students attended while in the country, I believe the most impactful was the class that Afro-Cuban intellectual and activist Roberto Servano taught after the group returned from a visit to the slave plantation. One never knows how they will respond to historical tragedy. I want to describe that moment for you. It was a group of about 15 students, many Latino, other students of European descent who were not Latino, and there were some students of African descent. There's two students, one in particular who was Dominican, and the other one who was Haitian. I want to talk a bit about this experience. I'm going to read here as I move towards the end. We stood in the midst of ruins on a Cuban slave plantation in Matanzas, where Africans had initiated insurrection against slavery and white supremacy. But some students seemed oblivious to the fact. They smiled carelessly. They took pictures of themselves and otherwise engaged the space as yet another tourist stop. I looked around and noticed that a couple of my students were missing. I went to the bus, only to find two young women of African descent in tears, despondent, upset, and nearly speechless. They didn't understand how their fellow students could respond to a slave plantation in such a casual manner. I do not believe the behavior of their fellow students represented callousness on their part. Rather, it demonstrated that they did not see themselves in the history of slavery. Their unthinking reaction proved that they participated in a different structure of feeling. We needed time to debrief. Following a visit to the Triunvirato sugar plantation in Matanzas province, my co-teacher Val Carnegie and I instructed the group to meet in order to discuss their radically different reactions to the plantation. It was pretty hush-hush. It was tense. I was convinced that we needed to debrief on the same day of the plantation visit so that the truest of sentiments would not be lost. The session was marked by anxiety and wearable tension. As the session progressed, a young student of Nigerian descent asked an unexpected question. Do you believe that blacks are still dealing with the repercussions of slavery today? The group was silent. Roberto Zurbano's response was commensurate to our collective need. Zurbano explained that individual reaction to human tragedy varies depending on an individual's relationship to the injured party. Blacks feel a sense of pain or shame with regard to the plantation because they maintain a common past with those that were enslaved. White emotional responses are not the same because their relationship to this historical space is profoundly different. Zurbano expounded on this point. He explained that whites enrich themselves from a series of processes that oppress non-Europeans, but they lack concrete historical knowledge about this aspect of their past. Racism is born in the home, where whites learn implicitly, and sometimes explicitly, that they are deserving of their social and economic status. For black people, the challenge of approaching the issue of racism is different. The agonizing sense of helplessness with regard to racism, neo-racism, and the not-so-distant past that produced these phenomena mean that black women and men may be consumed by rage, hatred, even violence. Zurbano's solutions reside in the realm of the reasonable, since they are based on non-violent measures to achieve the elimination of racial inequality. Zurbano's proposition that individuals and groups devoted to the cause of eliminating racism establish dialogues based on mutual respect, and they organize specific repertory programs that benefit descendants of the enslaved, and that they promulgate a system of anti-discrimination legislation, anti-discriminatory legislation. I want to talk a little bit more about the response of yet another student. So when I walked onto the bus, myself personally, it was difficult for myself. I thought I was going to cry. And I didn't know initially why the two young women were sitting there, and they explained it to me. But the debriefing process was key. The debriefing process of the 17 or so of us, 18 or so of us sitting there, of so many different cues with different histories, meant that we were not going to avoid the question. We weren't going to go to a historical space, experience it however we wanted, and then to leave. We were going to discuss our differences. And it was exceptionally productive. A couple of days later, I found myself pleasantly surprised by a young white Jewish female student who approached me after the roundtable discussion about a plantation visit. And she explained essentially that her experience, she was surprised that she was not able to feel in that space what she would feel at a Holocaust museum. I listened to her and told her this is a step in the direction of beginning the process of anti-racist thinking. And it was a very powerful but rare moment. A little too rare. I'm going to move towards the end here and share something with you in the interest of remembering. And that is two stanzas from a poem written by a black Cuban writer called Jose de Carmen Diaz. published initially in 1868 from a book called Canto del Esclavo, or Song of a Slave. Quote, "Do you see the coral of pine nuts beyond the slave huts where the Jews sing melancholy songs? Over there you catch sight of heaps of dirt with grave appearance, treeless, without mystery, with no crosses, without flowers, nothing. Come, this is the lowly cemetery of the blacks. The first one, I suppose, although covered with grass, is a poor unknown tomb of Mongongo. When I take a look at it, my soul is moved. It pities it harbor your bosom, mourn his fate, because the hour of his death was the best moment of his life." So the lyrical voice begins the poem by inviting the reader to the slave cemetery with him. And we have slave cemeteries right here in Charleston, or right here in South Carolina. He states the fact that there's no historical marker. The heaps of dirt with grave appearance, treeless. It's significant here that there are no crosses, because that suggests that there's no visible recognition of Christian belonging, no visible recognition of Christian laws, even though Africans were required to convert. There's no act of mourning. What essentially José de Carmelías does throughout this poem, these are only two stanzas of the poem, is that he turns the décima, the Spanish décima, into an epigraph, okay? And he tells a story of a different enslaved person in each décima. He names the unnamed. He remembers the value of black life. In conclusion, I want to invoke the words of Zaida Hartman. We must conjure the ghost of slavery to enslave the hopes of transforming the present. Hartman concludes, if the ghost of slavery still haunt our present, it is because we are still looking for an exit